Well, have you guys ever had a day where things just didn't work out for you? Things just didn't go well for you, where things were not working the way you had planned. Maybe it's a relationship issue and things started going south in this relationship, or maybe a computer problem at work and it just piled up more and more work for you throughout the day because it just wasn't working, or maybe a health-related issue, you're not feeling well, you're under the weather, or maybe something else. But I remember a job I had one time where I had to print envelopes. This was my job, running envelopes, an envelope press. And so part of the job was you had to set up this big, massive printing press to get the envelopes running very smoothly through this press. And it could print very fast. It could work really well. And I remember I had this order. I needed to print 150,000 envelopes. So it was a really big order to print all these envelopes. And I remember I got the press all set up. I got the ink all set up. I was making sure the colors were exactly right that the customer wanted. It was in the right spot. And I got all the envelopes feeding through. And so before I did that, I had all these two skids full of envelopes. Now the skid is like this wide and probably this tall, and it's just full of boxes of envelopes. And I had these two skids. So there's about 75,000 envelopes right there, about half the order. So I hit print, and I start going, and I'm boxing up all these envelopes and making sure everything's all set up properly and checking the envelopes to make sure that the color was right and in the right place and all that kind of stuff. And then after I finished printing 75,000 envelopes, after about 6 hours of work, I realized I made a mistake. Yeah, 75,000 envelopes are done. And that's 6 hours of work. I realize I make a mistake. And I printed the logo on the wrong envelope. I was supposed to use plain envelopes, but they were window envelopes. They had a window on them. The customer didn't want windows in their envelopes. They wanted a plain envelope. And so what did I do? I freaked out. I'm thinking, am I going to be fired? Am I going to be suspended? Am I going to have to pay for all these things? Like, this is thousands of dollars worth of envelopes. And you can't hide two skids of envelopes. There's a ton of envelopes right there for everyone to see that I made a mistake that day at work. And after a couple of hours just wondering, like I was walking around wondering, what am I going to do? What am I going to say? How am I going to get out of this thing? And I just thought, okay, Lord, what's the right thing for me to do? What's the right thing? And so obviously it's go talk to your boss. So I humbled myself and I went and told my boss. And he was so gracious, not like Nebuchadnezzar. He was very gracious here. And he just said, don't worry about it. We're going to fix it. Don't worry about it. We'll move the envelopes over here. We'll get you some more, and we'll fix it. Now, I don't know what happened to him. Maybe he got fired. I'm not too sure. But that was a bad day for me. Even as I went home that night, I remember thinking about it, stewing about it. I was anxious about the whole thing. Even though he was gracious, I still didn't sleep well. I was really worried. Now, we've all had bad days, whether there's a work problem, or maybe a relationship issue with someone, or your car breaks down and your house needs repairs and you don't have the money to pay for it. Or maybe you've received a diagnosis that you're sick and it's not going to be good for you and it's changing your life moving forward. Well, how do we respond to these things? Because these things, these difficulties, they're a fact. You can't change the difficulties that come your way. These are things that happen in each and every one of our lives. Life doesn't happen like you see on Facebook, where everything's perfect and shiny and nice. Life isn't always sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows. Sometimes life is really difficult. And this is where we pick up the story today in the life of Daniel. He's thrown into the midst of a very, very difficult situation. Today, Daniel's in a really tough spot. The king asks basically for an impossible request. It's essentially like me asking you, hey, I want you to tell me the dream that I had last night. And I'm not going to give you any details about the dream. You just have to tell me what dream I dreamt last night. I'm not going to tell you what food I had. I'm not going to tell you what I watched on TV that night. You just have to tell me what it was. And if you can't tell me the dream that I had, I'm going to cut you in pieces and burn your house down. Like, that's crazy. If someone said that to you, you'd call the police. This guy's nuts. Send him to jail. He's crazy. But unfortunately for Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar is the most powerful man in the world. He's above the police. He's above the law. In fact, Nebuchadnezzar is absolute in his power. He makes the laws. He decides what happens. There's no government around him. He is the government. And Daniel here is thrust into this situation, and so this is a really bad day for Daniel. And what we're going to learn is three really main things from this passage. You might see a couple other things, but we'll see three main things that stick out. Firstly, difficulties reveal your true character. Difficulties reveal your true character. When you're put in a difficult situation, how you act or how you respond, that's your true character. What comes out is who you really are. Secondly, we're going to peel back another layer on that first thing, and it may hurt a bit more, but how you respond to difficulties will also show you what you really think about God. How you respond to difficulties will show you what you really think about God. It'll show your level of trust in Him. It puts a spotlight right where your trust lies. It highlights what you think and you believe about God. Do you really believe He's able to get you through this situation? Do you think He loves you enough to get you out of the situation? That's what it shows. And thirdly, we'll see that whether you're in a difficulty, or maybe God gets you through the difficulty, or maybe you remain in the difficulty for a season, it's always appropriate to worship God. It's always right to worship God. God is worthy of our worship. And Daniel here, he's a great example of how we're supposed to respond during a time of crisis or time of difficulty. You see, Daniel, we see he calmly puts his trust in God Almighty because he knows God can help him. He knows that God's in control. He knows that God is working behind the scenes to make all these things happen. So this gives Daniel a confidence in his present situation. Daniel knows that God's going to deal with it, so we don't see Daniel freak out or run away. We see him calm and collect, and he's in a really tough situation. And God does indeed deal with the problem. Let's look at verse 1. Now in the second year of Nebuchadnezzar's reign, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams, and his spirit was so troubled that his sleep left him. Now verse 1, this is an important marker here. This tells us it's the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar. So it's really been about 2 years since Daniel has been taken captive, and there's a bit of uncertainty about what time this actually took place. And was Daniel finished the 3-year training course, or was it in the middle of this training course? Because kings at this time in Babylon, they judged their year of how long they've served. Their first year was really their inaugural year. Year 1 started after the inaugural first year. So regardless for us, though, Daniel is still quite young. He's in captivity, and he's only been a few years since he's been taken captive. And in this time, Nebuchadnezzar has these dreams. And these dreams, they're real, they're vivid, they don't make sense to him, and so much so that he's losing a lot of sleep. He can't sleep because of these things. They're really bothering him. And perhaps you've experienced that. I know I have. A time when you have trouble sleeping, it's not very fun. Where the cares of the day become the cares of the night, and you just start thinking about all these past things that have happened, the details, the conversations, the anxious moments that you faced, the problems, the difficulties, and you just can't sleep. You're just tossing and turning. And so Nebuchadnezzar has these dreams, and they're really messing him up. But why? Why are they messing him up? Well, in the ancient world, dreams were thought to be shadows of future events. See, a king's dream had really a lot of significance for the nation as a whole. The interpretation was so important because the king might get some important steps that he's supposed to take to remedy a certain situation, or to show him what's going to happen in the future so he could counteract an enemy that's coming. So he has these dreams, and they're messing him up because he doesn't understand them. He doesn't know what they mean. And it messes him up because he believes this is someone, or the gods are telling him about something in the future that's going to happen. And he wants to be prepared for it. Is someone coming to take over my kingdom, he's thinking? Is this dream warning me about an enemy? He doesn't know what it means, so he doesn't have a lot of peace. And being a new king, he obviously wants his kingdom to last. Now, we see the interpretation in next week's passage. But the dreams and interpretations, it's incredible. And it's so accurate that we're going to see next week, and it's why there's so much debate about the book of Daniel, the interpretation, because Daniel was written 600 years before Christ, and the dream essentially tells what's going to happen in the world for the next 600 years and years to come with incredible detail. It's pretty interesting to see. But what if you have a dream? Is that from God? Like, if you have this vivid, interesting dream tonight, is that from God? How do you know? Like, is God trying to speak to you through that dream? Well, ultimately, how we know if a dream is from God in the time we're living today, it's got to line up with the Word of God. Because primarily, this is how God speaks to us today, through His written Word. God shows us His desire for us, His plans for us. And God also speaks to us through His Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit leads us into truth. One author says this, with the Bible in his hand and the Holy Spirit in his heart, the Christian has ample provision for guidance into God's perfect will. However, dreams are a reality for a lot of people today. I mean, you just have to look at the Middle East. Jesus is showing up in a lot of people's dreams in the Middle East. People are having dreams and they're turning to Jesus, and these dreams, Jesus is telling them, hey, watch this program on TV. And so they watch it, and there's a guy, evangelist, sharing the gospel, and they get saved. There's a great book called Dreams and Visions, and it describes all of this. It's incredible to read about. And so how do you know if your dreams are from God? Well, if it lines up with what the Bible teaches. Does it line up with the Word of God? Or is it something super weird and something that goes against the teaching of the Bible? I mean, if it doesn't, if it's not clear, then you just need to leave it alone. You just need to put it away in a file and think about it. Don't act on it until God brings you clarity. See, God is certainly capable of speaking to us through dreams and visions, but he's also given us his word to guide us. Well, let's see what Nebuchadnezzar here does about his dreams. Verse 2. It says, then the king gave the command to call the magicians, the astrologers, the sorcerers, and the Chaldeans to tell the king his dreams. So they came and stood before the king, and the king said to them, I've had a dream, and my spirit is anxious to know the dream. So because Nebuchadnezzar is the king, he's the most powerful man in the world, he gathers all these people, these wise people, into the same room. It's like this big convention for the wisest people in Babylon at the time. So who are these people? Well, it says magicians. Now, these aren't people coming to do card tricks or to pull rabbits out of their hat. No, the Hebrew word here for magician describes a pen. So it's thought that these guys are scholars of sacred ancient writings, particularly with the occult kind of thing. And it says astrologers, these people would try to predict the future by watching the stars. These guys took it a bit further. They also tried to conjure up dead spirits to speak to them, to find out, hey, what's going on with Uncle Bob? Let's call Uncle Bob and try to raise him back. We'll conjure him up so that we can speak to him. Well, no, he's dead. You can't talk to him. Now, the next one says sorcerers. This is where people sold herbs and potions. This is your standard drug dealer today. The Hebrew word for sorcery was translated into the Septuagint. You guys know the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible. And the word translates into pharmakeia, which is drug use. So they'd be using these different things so they could get high, so they could experience and see certain different things about what was going on around them, and they'd use it to tell people's future. And lastly, it says the Chaldeans. Now, this could be referring to a people of Babylon. They're known as the Chaldeans, but specifically, this is referring to the wisest people in the land. They're known for their expertise in magic and also interpreting dreams. And it's known that these guys had these books for dream interpretation. These guys carried these books, and they said, if you had a dream about a tiger, let's turn to the tiger page. Oh, it means this. It means that your grandma's going to die. See, these guys, they were into dark and demonic things. This stuff was messed up that they were into. This isn't the good side of spirituality. This is the messed up spirit world. But this is their job. This is what they do for a living. This is what pays their wages and puts food on their table. They would contact the small g gods. They'd gain a secret from them, from the spirit world, and then they'd apply it to people's lives. They'd give them guidance or show them how they're supposed to be living. So Nebuchadnezzar gathers all these people together, and he has this big convention because he's anxious about his dreams. He wants to know what they mean, so he calls these people together to get some answers. And this is verse 4. Then the Chaldeans spoke to the king in Aramaic, O king, live forever. Tell your servants the dream, and we will give the interpretation. Now, this is a very reasonable request, is it not? Tell me the dream that you had. And once you tell me the dream, we'll all have a meeting, we'll talk about it, and then we'll tell you what it all means. Now, this was apparently standard procedure. Like, describe the dream, we'll figure it out, and we'll tell you what it means. Now, also, interesting side note here, notice that it says they spoke in Aramaic. At this point in the original language, the book of Daniel switches from Daniel 2, verse 4, to Daniel 7, verse 28. It switches to Aramaic. And it switches, and then it goes back to Hebrew. Now, it's pretty interesting. It's just for Bible trivia for you to have that. Aramaic, Greek, and Hebrew are the languages the Bible was written in. But let's see how the king responds here. Verse 5. It says, the king answered, said to the Chaldeans, my decision is firm. If you do not make known the dream to me and its interpretation, you shall be cut in pieces, and your houses shall be made an ash heap. However, if you tell the dream and its interpretation, you shall receive from me gifts, rewards, and great honor. Therefore, tell me the dream and its interpretation. The king wants them not only to tell them the interpretation, but also the dream itself. What was the dream that I had? And this is simply impossible. It's simply an impossible request. Something spiritual must be at work for this kind of information, because this dream happened in Nebuchadnezzar's head. You can't hit rewind or replay on a dream. You can't put a cone up to his head and it displays it on the big screen. This information has no human access. And he adds a ton of pressure to his request here. If you can't, you're going to be cut in pieces and your house will be made an ash heap. And he also offers a huge reward. There'll be blessings if you can do it. He says, tell me the dream and its interpretation. If you can't, you're going to be cut in pieces, house burned down. But if you can, there's lots of gifts. There's rewards for you. Now, I personally think with this, is this is incredibly wise of Nebuchadnezzar. Yeah, it's really harsh. You shouldn't do that. But it's wise because he wants to know what his dream means. And anyone that tell him what the dream was should be able to tell him the interpretation of the dream. So if a person can know what the dream actually was, then certainly they can know what the dream means. And the king here is essentially weeding out all the fakers. If there's some that are playing him and they're just in it for the paycheck each month, they really have no power or no skills to do this, then his request is really going to reveal who these people really are. It's going to reveal that they're liars and they're fakes. So it's a wise move, but it's also very harsh. Now, this is the beginning of a bad day. And I think the light bulb just went on for some of these wise people of this day to know that this is going to take a turn for the worse here. The king hasn't been sleeping. It's not good. The king has absolute power. He makes the laws. He decides the rules. There's no government around him. And he wants the answers or you're dead. So let's see how these guys respond. They answered again and said, let the king tell his servants the dream and we will give its interpretation. See, these guys understand the impossibility of this. Perhaps they've sold themselves on knowing and understanding all things, and they handed out flyers to everybody and said, come to me, come shop at my store, and I'll tell you everything that you need to know. And now it's been revealed that they really can't know it, and they're really being pushed and tested on this. So what does the king say? Verse 8. The king answered and said, I know for certain that you would gain time because you see that my decision is firm. If you do not make known the dream to me, there is only one decree for you. For you have agreed to speak lying and corrupt words before me till the time has changed. Therefore tell me the dream, and I shall know that you can give me its interpretation. Nebuchadnezzar's like, come on, you guys are chumps. You're stalling for time. And probably in the background, these guys are really hoping that their stall tactics will work. They're hoping that Nebuchadnezzar's mood is going to change. Like, if we can stall him, maybe he'll have a good sleep tonight, and then we can talk about it tomorrow, and then he'll give us more time or something. But Nebuchadnezzar says, no way, my decision is firm. I'm not changing my mind. You guys are just going to lie to me anyway, so let's get on with this. The king's really sifting through his advisors here. Some people say that these are probably the same advisors that were his father's advisors, and so he's really seeing who's worth their wages. And so the king sticks to his plan. If you can tell me the dream I had, then I'm pretty sure you have the correct interpretation. So what's their response? Once again, verse 10. The Chaldeans answered the king and said, there is not a man on earth who can tell the king's matters. Therefore, no king, lord, or ruler has ever asked such things of any magician, astrologer, or Chaldean. It is a difficult thing, yeah, obviously, that the king requests. And there is no other who can tell it to the king except the gods, whose dwelling is not with flesh. You know, they're right. Only God knows the answer to the king's request. And so the Chaldeans here are continuing to plead their case for this info about the dream. And they're essentially trying to deal with the king with this impossible request by trying to convince the king that he's being unreasonable. They're saying, hey, listen, man, no one's asked to do this in the past. No one's asked for this. It's not normal. Why would you do this? And they didn't want to admit that they couldn't do it because that would be admitting they're false, that they really had no power. And that their gods couldn't really do that. Their gods were small g and they really had no power. And they'd lose their job and they'd probably lose their lives. But they say something interesting about it here. They say, the only one who would know is the gods. Obviously referring to their false gods. But then they say, whose dwelling is not with flesh. See, now these guys and the people around King Nebuchadnezzar at this time, they learned an important lesson about the God of heaven here. The God of all creation, the God of the universe through this experience. The people remembered this moment. Turn to Daniel chapter 5. A couple chapters over. Daniel chapter 5. And the context is Nebuchadnezzar's son is king. His name is Belshazzar. There's this huge feast, and you remember the story. There's this mysterious hand. It appears on the wall, and it starts writing these weird words on the wall, and they don't know what it means or what's going on, and they're freaking out. They don't know what to do, and he calls all the magicians, all the astrologers and the Chaldeans to try to tell him what this all means, and they couldn't do it. So his mom says this to him in verse 11. There is a man in your kingdom in whom is the spirit of the holy God, In the days of your father, light and understanding and wisdom, like the wisdom of the gods, were found in him. And King Nebuchadnezzar, your father the king, made him chief of the magicians, astrologers, Chaldeans, and soothsayers. Inasmuch as an excellent spirit, knowledge, and understanding, interpreting dreams, solving riddles, and explaining enigmas were found in this Daniel, whom the king named Belshazzar, now let Daniel be called, and he will give the interpretation. But the thing I want you to notice in that those verses is that the spirit of the Holy God was found in Daniel. The spirit of Holy God was found in Daniel's flesh. This is what Belshazzar's mom thought. This is the testimony that Daniel had. Now back in Daniel 2, these guys know the limitation of their small g gods. He doesn't dwell with flesh, is what they say. It's impossible for them to get any kind of power, any kind of wisdom or insight from their small g gods. But that's not our God. John 1:14 says, the word became flesh and dwelt among us. God became flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus Christ left heaven, came to earth as a baby, put on flesh, and dwelt among us. And also right before Jesus died on the cross, he said to his disciples, it is to your benefit that he goes away so that he can send the Helper, the Holy Spirit. Do you understand? The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Holy God, resides in you if you're a believer in Jesus Christ. The moment you put your trust in Jesus, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit. It's a guarantee that you are paid for and you are going to heaven. The Spirit of Holy God is with you and in you, and he's there to help you and guide you into truth, to convict you of sin, to comfort you, and to help you. You know, sometimes we think, and I'm included, when you see someone do something amazing, spiritual thing, or something that happens, you think, well, I could never, ever do that. And you're right. You could never do that. We're going to see that as we move on. Daniel could never, ever, ever interpret this dream. But the Spirit of the living God can. See, many of us, we don't step out with certain callings. Many of us, we're scared maybe to speak up. Or some of us, we don't get direction for our lives. Or we stay stuck in a life of sin because we're trying to do it on our own. But the Spirit of the living God, the Spirit of Holy God is in you. Jesus said he's there to help you. So listen, church, when faced with something difficult, remember who you are. Remember what God has done for you. Remember how special you are. Remember how special you are to him. And that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. See, if you see something impossible that's before you, have faith in God. Believe that God can do it. Believe that God will help you. Look to the Bible and be reminded of all the times that God helped other people with these things. And step out in faith. Because the Spirit of the Holy God is in you. Take the risk. Watch what God does with it. And we're going to see more of that as we move on. But first, let's see how the king responds to all these guys' excuses. Verse 12. For this reason, the king was angry and very furious and gave the command to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. So the decree went out, and they began killing the wise men, and they sought Daniel and his companions to kill them. So the king is really obviously mad here. And you don't want to get the king mad. And he does something fairly irrational. He's like, that's it. You're all going to die. Everyone has to die. All the wise counselors, you're going to die. So this is a really bad day for these people. This is a lot worse than printing 75,000 envelopes on the wrong envelope. This is really, really bad. On the king's orders, the wise men of Babylon are ordered to be killed, and the king's men start fulfilling that order. People start dying because of this. And they're looking for Daniel and his friends. And that's where the story shifts. And it's pretty cool. It shifts to the hero of the story here. Verse 14. Then with counsel and wisdom, Daniel answered Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, who had gone out to kill the wise men of Babylon. He answered and said to Arioch, the king's captain, why is the decree from the king so urgent? Then Arioch made the decree or the decision known to Daniel. I love how this story shifts here. And it's really comparing and contrasting. It's comparing and contrasting the so-called wise men of Babylon, all those chumps, the bumbling fools that don't have anything going on, and they're stalling and hoping the king changes his mind, to Daniel, who's trusting in God, a 17-year-old teenager. And it says he's acting and he's speaking with counsel and wisdom. It's amazing to see. Now, counsel and wisdom, another translation says wisdom and tact. Daniel responds appropriately. He responds properly. Another word for it is discretion. He has discretion. He knows what to say. He handled himself in an amazing way. Like you picture the scene, who knows? Like, Arioch is there with sword in hand, dripping in blood, perhaps, fresh off of killing someone, and he knocks on the door. And Daniel opens up the door, and he's like, hey, what's going on? Oh, it's Arioch. Wow, what is going on here, man? And Daniel, respectful, he has tact with his approach, and he has real spiritual wisdom to answer this. You know the proverb, a soft answer turns away wrath. Daniel displays some fruit here. He applies what the Bible says, and he does the right thing. He's calm, he's cool, and he's collect in his response. And Daniel says, hey, why does this have to be done so quick? Like, can we talk about this? Take a minute here, man. Have a snack. So this guy, Daniel, explains, this guy, Arioch, explains everything to Daniel, and he's probably explaining, like, well, you know the king, he hasn't been sleeping well, and he's pretty grumpy when he doesn't sleep, and he gathered all these magicians and astrologers, and, you know, some of them are probably stoned, like they're token up, and we don't know what these guys are doing, or what they're, and they really ticked off the king here, and so now we have to go kill all these guys. And so Daniel responds properly. He's calm, he has character. He shows us the right way to respond in this. So now this is the first point I want to mention here. Difficulties reveal your character. See, a time of crisis. This is a difficult time. This guy's been ordered to kill Daniel and his friends. And what does Daniel do? He doesn't freak out. Daniel doesn't try to kill Arioch. He doesn't try to steal his sword and stab him. He doesn't run away. Daniel doesn't lie, and he says, well, I'm actually not a part of the wise men. These guys just asked me to come over here and play Yahtzee with them tonight, and I'm just here playing a game with them. And he doesn't lie. No, he respectfully asks a question here. And this reveals Daniel's character. This was a young man that really had it all together here. He knew the scriptures. He knew how to respond. He applied the scripture to his life, and when he needed it most, he was acting it out. See, listen, when we're put in a difficult situation, who you are truly comes out. What you're made of comes out. And as a Christian in a time of difficulty, biblical principles should come out. It's like a K-cup. You know those things, the Keurig coffee machines? It's like if we had a little K-cup and all the logos, all the writing was scrubbed off of that K-cup. And so you didn't know what was on the inside of that cup. So you put it in the machine. The machine stabs the top and the bottom of the cup, and some really hot water drains through that cup. And what drips out of that machine is what was inside that cup. The true ingredients were revealed. Was it coffee? Was it tea? Was it hot chocolate? And this is what happens when we go through a difficulty. We get poked. We get put in some hot water. And our true ingredients get revealed. Out they come. Are they biblical? Are they godly? Is it the fruit of the Spirit or is it fleshly? Is it unreasonable? Will it be embarrassing to you? And how do you respond? Like, how do you respond to bad news or difficulties in life? Do you react like Nebuchadnezzar? Do you freak out? Do you lose your cool? Do you say things you're probably later going to regret? Do you act foolish? Are you unreasonable? I hope you don't give anyone any death threats. Or do you respond like Daniel? Calm, respectful, with tact, with wisdom. Trying to figure out a good outcome to the situation. Applying what the Bible says. Displaying the fruit of the Spirit like patience. Like self-control, kindness, and gentleness. And that's hard when you're under the pressure. When you're in the hot water, it's hard to respond like that. So listen, consider it. If you don't like what comes out, you got to pray. You got to ask God, God, change me. Help me to respond properly when I'm put in that hot water. Help me to respond properly when I'm poked. Because I don't like who I am when that happens. Now Daniel here does something incredibly bold. In verse 16, so Daniel went in and asked the king to give him time that he might tell the king the interpretation. So in the midst of this crisis, Daniel does something incredibly bold. He said, I'm just going to go talk to the king. I'm just going into the king to talk to him. That's taking your life into your hands. You don't just go in to go see the king. Daniel displays this amazing, amazing trust and amazing confidence in God. He knows God's got his back. And he believes that so much so that he takes a bold step of faith. He's like, God's got this. Let me go talk to the king. Goes into the king, tells him, hey, man, give me a day. Let me pray about this. God's going to show me. We'll stop all this nonsense. God will take care of it. You'll know what the dream was. And notice he asked for the same thing that these chumps were asking for. More time. The king didn't give them more time, but he gives Daniel more time. Perhaps because he knows Daniel's character. Perhaps because he could see that Daniel was genuine in his request. See, the trust that Daniel has in God is incredible. Just give me some time. I'll pray about it, and I'll tell you what this dream means. He's confident God's going to give him the interpretation. I wish I was that confident with some of my prayers. This is incredible trust in God. It's an impossible situation, and he trusts God for it. That's the second thing. How you react during a time of crisis shows what you really believe about God. I mean, for you, who's the first person that you phone when you need help? Who's the first person? You're thinking about someone now. Whether it's your mom or your dad or sister or brother or friend, the fact that you turn to that person in a time of need says a lot about that relationship. It shows a strong, trustful relationship that you go to them because you know that they have wisdom and you want that wisdom in that time of need. Now, do you have this trust or confidence in God when your day takes a turn for the worse? Do you believe God's got your back? Do you know that he'll deal with it? Do you take steps of faith to fix it like we see Daniel do? Or do you freak out? Do you freak out on other people? Do you crawl into a hole and turn on Netflix and hoping the world just goes away? I mean, think about it. If Daniel freaked out, if Daniel ran away, what does that say about his God? I mean, he doesn't believe God can help him if he ran away. He doesn't believe his God is powerful enough. All the promises in Scripture are not true to Daniel. He doesn't believe that God can help him in his situation if he freaks out and if he runs away. But Daniel doesn't respond like that. He takes a bold step of faith, trusting that God's got his back. He believes and he knows that God's got it. Do you trust him like that? Do you trust God that way? Are you this bold when there's a problem going on in your life? Like, it's not my problem, it's God's problem. God is capable. God is able of solving this problem. He loves me. So I'm looking to him for the solution. I may have gotten myself into this mess, but I've got a loving Heavenly Father that's on my side and that wants to help. That should be our response. Well, the king here is obviously favorable to Daniel's request because in verse 17, Daniel is still alive. It says this, Then Daniel went to his house and made the decision known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, that they might seek the mercies from the God of heaven concerning this secret, so that Daniel and his companions might not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. So the king says, sure, have another day. We'll figure this out. So Daniel goes home to his friends, and they're most likely roommates at this place. They probably live close to the palace. And he tells them all about what just happened, and they begin to pray together. I read a cute phrase this week. It says, prayer is always more effective than panic. It absolutely is. We can get so wound up with panic and stress and anxiety, and when we just pause to pray, we'll get better results. So Daniel and his buddies, they do the right thing. And Daniel was bold, and he believed God will help him out. Now he's praying for that help. He's praying that God will fill in the blanks here. He's praying for the results. Jeremiah 33:3 is a great verse. It says, call to me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which you do not know. And Daniel's doing just that. He's calling out to God. He doesn't know what the answer is. He has no clue what the answer is. But he's going to God and he's asking for help. And it says they're seeking the mercies of the God of heaven. Titus 3:4-5 says this, but when the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not of works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. Also Hebrews 4:16 says, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. See, it's through God's mercy that you've been forgiven and that you have new life. It's through God's mercy that he blesses you and he helps you with your current situation and things going on. It's the mercy of God at work in your life. See, seeking the mercies of God is simply humbly calling out for God to show you compassion, for his compassion to be on display. It's simply asking for his help, where you say, God, I know I'm a sinner. I've messed this up. I know oftentimes I don't get it right, but God, I trust in you. I'm coming to you because I need your help. And that's what Daniel and his friends are doing. They know where the answer to their problem is to be found. It's found with the God of heaven. And so they're calling out to him for an answer. And I want you to notice the fellowship of these guys, his buddies. He gathers his buddies to pray. There's something really special, really powerful about praying together in a group. Men's prayer, women's prayer, refresh groups like Steve talked about, especially if you're in need. Bring your need to the group. Tell the group, listen, I've got this thing going on and I need some help. I need prayer. There's something powerful. There's something humbling about praying together with other believers because you know that you're all reaching up to heaven to God. You're calling out to the mercies of God, asking him to respond and intervene in your situation. Well, let's see how God responds. Verse 19. Then the secret was revealed to Daniel in a night vision. So Daniel blessed the God of heaven. It says it so matter-of-factly there, doesn't it? Like, the secret was revealed. It's kind of, no, this is a huge deal. The secret was revealed. Like, the secret was revealed. A private dream that only happens in someone's head was revealed to Daniel. That's huge. And notice Daniel doesn't have a dream to see this. This is a night vision. He's not asleep. He's wide awake. And I don't think I'd be sleeping either if I had to go answer the king the next day. I'd probably be awake. And so this night vision happens, and Nebuchadnezzar's dream unfolds before him like a movie on that screen. He sees exactly in perfect detail what this dream was, and we'll see it next week. And then it says, Daniel blesses the God of heaven. Man, I bet you he did. Verse 20, Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. You know, when you see someone in Scripture praising the name of God, they're essentially praising God for his revealed character. God's name is attached to his character, just like your name is attached to your character. Daniel's saying, God came through. God has shown me that he loves me. God's character's on display. God came through for me. And Daniel begins to share some things that are God's alone. They aren't Daniel's. Daniel couldn't do this. They're God's. It says wisdom and might are his. Wisdom's not Daniel's. Might is not Daniel's. It's God's. Wisdom and might, they belong to God. Verse 21, and he changes the times and the seasons. He removes kings and raises up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. Daniel praises God for the things that only God can do. You can't change the seasons. I'd like to. I'd like to stop it and keep it summer right now, but it's going to change. No, only God can do that. You can't remove and raise up kings. That's God's responsibility. You can't give wisdom. Yes, you can give your advice on certain things, but any wisdom that comes out of your mouth is ultimately from the throne room of heaven. It's from God. Knowledge to those who have understanding. God gives these things. And verse 21 tells us that Daniel is praising God for his total control over life. He praises God because God is sovereign over all the nations. He praises God because God is the source of all wisdom. And he just gave some to Daniel. The list continues, verse 22. He reveals deep and secret things. He knows what is in the darkness, and light dwells with him. This is essentially telling us that nothing, absolutely nothing, is hidden from God. Maybe you have a problem and you cannot see the solution, and you're looking through a fog. You can't really see where the solution lies, and it seems like you're in the midst of this darkness. Well, God sees it in perfect light. Maybe you've played hide and seek. I play a lot of hide and seek in my days. But you try playing it in the dark. It's really difficult to find people, especially if they're sneaking around behind your back. You can't find those people. It's way easier if you just turn the lights on and you see those people everywhere. God sees everything with perfect clarity. The lights are on to God. God sees your situation. God knows what's around the corner in your situation. He knows how to help you and to deal with those things. Just like Nebuchadnezzar's dreams, God knew what it was. See, Daniel here recognizes and he understands this wasn't because of him. Daniel recognizes this is all from God. So Daniel is worshiping God. Daniel is pausing to praise God for who he is and for what he's done for Daniel. Verse 23. I thank you and praise you, O God of my fathers. You have given me wisdom and might, and you have made known to me what we asked of you, for you have made known to us the king's demand. Question. How did Daniel know it was right? Like, he hasn't told the king, and the king hasn't said, yes, that's exactly the dream that I had. How does Daniel know the dream is correct? He hasn't presented it to the king yet. Listen, Daniel has a certainty of faith to believe God. He knows that God gave him the answer, even before confirming it to Nebuchadnezzar. You know when you pray for something and God just speaks to your heart after a time of prayer? You just know God spoke. You're certain, you're confident, you have a peace about it. And peace floods your heart and your mind. And Daniel's in this place, and he's praising God because of what God has shown him. And Daniel goes in to see the king. Before he goes in, he praises God. Now, it's not that Daniel figured this out with his own skill. Daniel trusted in God, and God did it. Daniel recognizes that God gave him wisdom about the dream and the situation and how to act throughout the whole process. God gave him the whole thing. Daniel recognizes that God gave him the might, the strength to act, probably when his strength was failing, when he saw that bloody sword in front of him. God gave him the strength and the boldness to go into the king, and God gave him the wisdom to interpret this dream. This wasn't his to begin with, but God gave it. It wasn't normal or natural for Daniel to have all these things, so Daniel pauses to praise God. Now, this is the last part of the application. It's always appropriate to worship God. Always. I mean, Daniel, in this situation, he got a pretty quick answer because there was a pretty quick time frame on this. And maybe for you guys, you haven't received an answer yet. You've been praying, you've been asking, you haven't seen anything. I'm going to challenge you. Just because you haven't received an answer doesn't mean you stop worshiping and praising God. It doesn't mean that God has forgotten you. See, God is still worthy of your worship. Listen, these things that Daniel lists here of worship into God, they're true about God regardless of what's happening in your life. These are true about God. These are things you can worship God for. God can be praised for changing the seasons or for the creation that's around you. God can be praised because he's in control of what's going on in this world. God can be praised because when you need it, he will give you wisdom and strength. God deserves your worship. And sometimes a time of worship is exactly what you need. It kind of highlights the situation in your mind. It gives you clarity with the situation. It can refresh you. It changes your perspective. It'll give you strength. God will give you direction through that time. God may even encourage you to see that he's got it. He's going to take care of me. See, God sent his son to die for you. He's proven. He's already proven that he's on your side. So he will continue to take care of you. And so this is why we're going to spend a bit more time worshiping God today, because we want to give you a chance to respond. Maybe you've had a bad day. Maybe you've had a bad month. And you need to see God on the move. Or perhaps your character is weak, and you've realized that your trust in God is pretty low, and you want to change that. Or maybe there's an impossible situation before you. You don't see the way out. You don't understand how you're going to get through that situation. Or maybe you need confidence in your present situation. It doesn't come from you having positive thoughts and putting a smile on your face. It comes from you getting your eyes on God. Maybe you need faith to walk through a situation. You just don't see how God's going to get you through it, or the difficulty, or where the money's going to come from at the end of the month. You got to get back to that place of worshiping God. To see that God is bigger. To see that he is worthy. Before I came out here, I was reading Psalm 124 in the prayer room. It says, "Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth."